I'm going to discuss the topic neural control and coordination. That is actually the part 2. And here I'll be discussing sense organs, eye, ear, chemoreceptors that are smell and taste receptors and touch receptors. Now, sense organs. The sensory organs detect all types of changes in the environment and send appropriate signals to the central nervous system where all the inputs are processed and analyzed. There, the signals are then sent to different parts or centers of the brain. Now, the sensory system consists of eye for vision, ear for hearing, chemoreceptors, that is the sensory organ for smell and taste, and the sensory receptors for touch. Now, there are 5 senses, that is touch, vision, hearing, smell and taste. And generally, the sense organs are divided into 2. Touch is a complex general sense, while the other 4, that is the vision, hearing, smell and taste, they come under special senses. So, touch comes under general sense and the rest of the 4 come under the special senses. Now, what is general sensory receptors? The general sensory receptors are simple receptors that are modified dendritic ends of sensory neuron. So, they are simple, they are modified dendritic ends of sensory neuron. They are present throughout the body, that is in the skin, mucous membrane, connective tissue and muscles. They monitor most of the types of general sensory information like what? A mix of touch, pressure, stretch and vibration. These all come under tactile sensation. Heat, cold, pain and muscle sense. And muscle sense especially comes under proprioception. So, they help in the tactile sensation. Heat, cold, pain and muscle sense, that is proprioception. Now, the second part is special sensory receptors. The special sensory receptors are distinct receptor cells actually confined to the head region and are highly localized with complex sensory organs like eyes and ears, taste buds and olfactory epithelium. So, what are the characters? Distinct receptor cells, localized in head region, highly complex, example eyes, ears, taste buds and olfactory epithelium. These sensory organs and tissues are collection of cells of many types, that is receptor and non-receptor cells, which work together to accomplish a specific receptive process. Now, the first sense organ, that is the eye, our paired eyes are located in the socket of the skull called orbits. The wall of the eyeball is made up of 3 layers. Here you can see the 3 layers. The external layer is composed of a dense connective tissue that is called sclera. This thick region, the outermost dense connective tissue layer, it is called the sclera. The anterior portion of this layer is called cornea. The sclera at the exposed part, this blue color, this is called the cornea through which the light enters. The middle layer is the choroid that contains many blood vessels. This brown color, brown layer, this is called the choroid. It consists of many blood vessels. The choroid layer is thin over the posterior 2/3 of the eyeball, but it becomes thick in the anterior part. You follow this dark brown line. Here you can see this is thin at the 2/3 part of the eye, but at the anterior part it is thick and this is called ciliary body. The ciliary body continues forward and form a pigmented opaque structure, the iris. Here you follow the ciliary body. This is the ciliary body and it follows as the iris. And iris, this is the visible colored portion of the eye. The eyeball contains a transparent lens. Here you can see the lens, a crystalline lens that is held in place by the suspensory ligaments and that are held in place by the ciliary body. So, altogether the lens, it is held in position by the suspensory ligament and the ciliary body. In front of the lens, the aperture surrounded by the iris is called the pupil. This is the iris and at the center there is an opening, and that is called the pupil, through which the light enters. The diameter of the pupil is regulated by muscle fibers of the iris. The muscle fibers present in the iris will control the diameter of the pupil. The inner layer is the retina. Here you can see this light yellow color that covers the 2/3 region of the eye, and that is the retina. And this retina contains three layers. Here you can see the enlarged part, three layers, that is from inside to outside. This is very important. It consists of a layer of ganglion cells, a layer of bipolar cells, and last a layer of photoreceptor cells. So this is from inside to the outside. Okay, that is, it consists of a ganglion layer, a bipolar cell layer, and a photoreceptor cells. There are two types of photoreceptors. Here you can see an elongated photoreceptor and a stout photoreceptor, and these are called, this is the cone and this is the rod. And these cells contain light sensitive proteins called the photopigments. They contain light sensitive proteins called the photopigments. The daylight vision is also called photopic vision, and the color vision are the functions of cone. So with the help of cone, we can see the daylight, that is the daylight vision, that is a photopic vision, and the color vision. And the twilight, that is the dawn, or the dim light vision, it is the function of the rods, and such vision is called scotopic vision. The rods contain a purplish red protein that is called the rhodopsin, or visual purple. I've already told you that they contain light sensitive photopigment. The rods contain rhodopsin or visual purple. And actually the rhodopsin is a derivative of vitamin A. In the human eye, there are three types of cone that possess their own characteristic photopigments, and they respond to red, green, and blue lights. So there are three cones, that is a red cone, green cone, and the blue cone. And they are activated according to these lights. The sensation of different colors, though we have these three primary cones, we see different colors. So the sensation of different colors are produced by various combination of these cones and their photopigments. When these cones are stimulated equally, a sensation of white light is produced. So all these three cones, when they are stimulated equally, you will see the white light. The optic nerve leaving the eye at a point slightly above the posterior pole of the eyeball. This is the optic nerve that leaves the eyeball at the posterior pole. The photoreceptor cells are not at all present in this region. So this region is called the blind spot. Where the optic nerve leaves, that area does not contain any photoreceptors, and that area is called blind spot. At the posterior pole of the eye, that is lateral to the blind spot, that is exactly here, there is an yellowish pigmented spot that is called the macula lutea, with a depression at the center called fovea. That is, lateral to the blind spot, there is an area that is called the macula lutea with a depression at the center, that is called the fovea. Here you can see only the cones. Here the cones are densely packed. So this is the point where the visual acuity is the greatest. It is the region of greatest vision. The space between the cornea, you can see the two chambers here. The space between the cornea and the lens, this blue shaded region, it is the aqueous chamber, and it contains a thin watery fluid, and it is called aqueous humor. The space between the lens and the retina, here you can see the large space, and this is called the vitreous chamber, and it is filled with a transparent gel that is called vitreous humor. So here it is aqueous chamber between the cornea and the lens, filled with watery fluid, that is aqueous humor. And here it's a large space between the lens and the retina, that is vitreous chamber, filled with a gel-like liquid, and that is called the vitreous humor. Now let's see the mechanism of vision. The light rays in visible wavelength are focused on the retina through the cornea and lens. They generate the potentials in rods and cones. So the light enters through the cornea, focused on the retina by the lens. And there it creates potentials in rods and cones. The photosensitive compounds in the human eye is composed of opsin and retinal. rhodopsin. Rhodopsin is found in the roots and it consists of two parts, opsin, that is a protein part, and retinal, that is actually an aldehyde of the vitamin A. So these two parts form the rhodopsin. So when light falls on the retina, the light induces the dissociation of retinal from the opsin, resulting in the changes in the structure of the opsin. So when the light falls on the retina, the rhodopsin is converted into opsin and the retinal, and this creates a change in the entire opsin and thus causes the membrane permeability changes. As a result, the potential differences are generated in the photoreceptor cells. This produces a signal that generates action potential in the ganglion cells through the bipolar cells. These action potentials are transmitted by the optic nerve to the visual cortex, where the impulses are analyzed and images formed. Here you can see the potential differences occur in the rods and cones due to the effect of light on the opsin, the effect of light on the rhodopsin pigment, and this is these potential differences, they are transported to bipolar cells. From there they are received by the ganglion cells, and these ganglion cells, they form the optic nerve, you can see here, and this optic nerve carry these impulses to the visual cortex area of the brain, where the nerve impulses are analyzed and the images seen. Okay. Now coming to the ear performs two sensory functions, that is hearing and maintenance of body balance. Anatomically, the ear can be divided into three regions. What are they? The outer ear, the middle ear, and the inner ear. Now, outer ear, it consists of the pinna. This is the flap, that the external ear, this is the pinna, and the external auditory meatus or the auditory canal. The pinna collects the vibration in the air, which produces the sound. The external auditory meatus leads inward and extends up to the tympanic membrane. This is called the eardrum or the tympanic membrane. So, pinna, external ear or ear canal or the auditory canal, and the eardrum or the tympanic membrane. There are very fine hairs and wax secreting sebaceous glands in the skin of the pinna and the meatus. In the auditory meatus, there are hairs and wax secreting sebaceous gland. The tympanic membrane, it is composed of connective tissue covered with skin outside and with mucous membrane inside. So, what is this tympanic membrane? It is made up of connective tissue covered with the skin on the outside surface and with mucous membrane on the inside surface. The middle ear. Now, coming to the middle ear, it consists of three ear ossicles. What are they? Malleus, that is hammer shaped, incus, that is anvil shaped, and stapes, that is stirrup shaped. So, they are attached to one another in a chain like fashion. Malleus, incus, and stapes. Now, the malleus is attached to the tympanic membrane. You can see here the malleus is attached to the tympanic membrane. The stapes is attached to the oval window of the cochlea. The stapes, it is attached to the, in the middle ear, it ends with two windows, that is the oval window and round window. These windows are membrane bound pores. So, the stapes is attached to the oval window of the cochlea. The ear ossicles increase the efficiency of transmission of sound waves to the inner ear. That is a function of the ear ossicles. Now, there is an eustachian tube that connects the middle ear with the pharynx. This is the eustachian canal or the tube that connects the air-filled middle ear with the pharynx. The eustachian tube helps in equalizing the pressures on either side of the eardrum. So, it helps, this is the eardrum. So, it helps in equalizing the pressures on either side of the eardrum. Now, internal ear is fluid-filled and it is called labyrinth. It consists of two parts, the bony labyrinth and the membranous labyrinth. This is the inner ear. The bony labyrinth is a series of channels. Inside these channels lie the membranous labyrinth. This blue color is the membranous labyrinth, and this bony structure, it is the bony labyrinth. And this membranous labyrinth is surrounded by a fluid that is called the perilymph. And inside the membranous labyrinth, there is a fluid called endolymph. So listen carefully. The internal ear is made up of two parts, the bony labyrinth and the membranous labyrinth. The membranous labyrinth is surrounded by perilymph, but it is filled with a fluid called endolymph. The coiled portion of the labyrinth is called cochlea. Here you can see, this is the cochlea, this coiled portion. The membrane constituting cochlea, there are two membranes, that is the Reisner's membrane and the basilar membrane. Here you can see the basilar membrane and the Reisner's membrane. This is a circular section of the cochlea. Now the membrane, that is the Reisner's and basilar, divide the surrounding perilymph filled bony labyrinth into an upper scalar vestibuli and a lower scalar tympani. So you can see the three chambers. This is the scalar vestibuli, scalar tympani. These two are filled with perilymph, and at the middle there is a cavity or the chamber, and that is the cochlear duct or the scalar media, and this is filled with endolymph. So the Reisner's membrane will divide the scalar vestibuli from the scalar media. The basilar membrane divides the scalar media from the scalar tympani. And these scalar vestibuli and tympani are filled with perilymph. Only the scalar media is filled with endolymph. So the space within the cochlea, that is the scalar media, is filled with the endolymph. Okay. Now the organ of Corti is a structure located on the basilar membrane that contains hair cells that act as auditory receptors. You can see on the basilar membrane there are specific receptor cells, hair cells, and these form the organ of Corti. The hair cells are present in rows on the inner side of the organ of Corti. The basal end of the hair cell is in close contact with the afferent nerve fiber. You can see the basal end of the hair cells are in close contact with the auditory nerve fibers. A large number of processes called stereocilia projected from the apical part of each hair cell. If you see here clearly, you can see the white portion from the upper part of the hair cells arise a particular cilia that is called stereocilia. Above the rows of hair cell is a thin elastic membrane that is called the tectorial membrane. Here you can see the light delicate membrane, that is an overhanging membrane arising from the basilar membrane that overhangs the organ of Corti, and this is called tectorial membrane. Now the next part, at the base of the cochlea, this is the cochlea. The scalar vestibuli ends at the oval window, while the scalar tympani terminates at the round window, which opens to the middle ear. So there is a continuous connection between the middle ear and the internal ear. That is the scalar vestibuli, it is in contact with the oval window. The scalar tympani is in contact with the round window. This continuation is very important, that we will discuss in the mechanism of hearing. The inner ear also contains a complex system called vestibular apparatus that is located above the cochlea. So this is the vestibular apparatus. It is composed of, you can see, the three semicircular canals and the otolith organ. This is the otolith organ consisting of saccule and utricle. So three semicircular canals and the utricle and the saccule. Okay. Each semicircular canal lies in a different plane at right angle to each other. Here you can see clearly they are at right angles to one another. The base of the canal is swollen. Here the base of the canal is swollen, and that is called ampulla, and it contains a projecting ridge. When you, the inside, you can see a projecting ridge, and this is called crista ampullaris, which has hair cells. These are the hair cells. You can see the projecting hair or the stereocilia. So this is the ampulla of the semicircular canals, and that contain a projecting ridge called crista ampullaris. Now this is the saccule and vestibule. Utricle contain a projecting ridge. Inside also you can see the dark part, and this is the projecting ridge, and that is called macula. So in the ampulla there is crista, in the vestibule there are macula. So crista and macula are specific receptors of vestibular apparatus that is responsible for maintenance of balance of body and posture. So maintaining the body posture and balance, the action come under the crista and macula. Crista are present in the ampulla of semicircular canal, macula are present in the utricle and saccule. Now, mechanism of hearing. The external ear receives sound waves and direct them towards the eardrum. This is the external ear that receives the sound waves and they are directed towards the eardrum. The eardrum vibrates in response to the sound waves and these vibrations are transmitted through the ear ossicles to the oval window. Here you can see the pinna collects the sound waves, conducts it through the external auditory meters. They reach the tympanic membrane that will vibrate and these vibrations are passed on to the malleus, incus and stapes, and in the stapes is in connection with oval window. So the vibrations they pass to oval window. The vibration through the oval window, they get into the fluids of cochlea, this blue color, where they generate waves in the lymph, endolymph. Here actually the blue color is actually the perilymph. The waves in the limbs induce a ripple in the basilar membrane. So this is the basilar membrane. So the waves in the lymph, they will cause a ripple in the basilar membrane. This basilar membrane bend the hair cells, pressing them against the tectoral membrane. You have to see that the tectoral membrane overhangs the hair cells. So when the basilar membrane moves, it causes the bending of hair cells and press them against the tectoral membrane. There the nerve impulses are generated. These impulses are transmitted by the afferent fibers via the auditory nerves to the auditory cortex of the brain, where the impulses are analyzed and the sound is recognized. So once again, the mechanism of hearing, that is, at first the sound waves are collected by the pinna, conducted through the external auditory canal. It reaches the tympanic membrane that starts to vibrate. Vibrations are passed on to malleus, incus, stapes to the oval window. Oval window causes the vibration in the lymph or the ripples. It creates ripples in the lymph that causes the ripples to pass on to the basilar membrane. This causes the bending of the hair cells. Thereby, they touch the tectoral membrane and create the impulse. And these impulses are transmitted by the afferent fibers through the auditory nerves to the auditory cortex of the brain, where the impulses are analyzed and the sound is recognized. Now, chemoreceptors. The receptors for taste and smell are classified as chemoreceptors. They respond to special chemicals in aqueous solution. In each case, the chemicals must go into solution. This is important. They can only respond to special chemicals in aqueous solution. So, the chemicals must go into solution in the film of liquid coating the membranes of the receptor cell before these can be detected. The sense of smell, that is the olfaction. Nose contains the receptor of smell in the mucus-coated thin yellowish patch of modified pseudo-stratified epithelium called olfactory epithelium. This is the nasal chamber. Here you can see a mucus-coated modified pseudo-stratified epithelium, and that is called the olfactory epithelium. It is located way up at the roof of the nasal cavity, exactly here, on either sides of the nasal septum. The olfactory epithelium consists of three types of cells. What are they? These are the millions of olfactory receptor cells. They are bipolar neurons, and the columnar supporting cells. You can see the supporting cells and some short basal cells. So these are the olfactory receptor cells, columnar supporting cells and some short basal cells. Olfactory receptors, like I said earlier, they are unusual. Why? Because they are bipolar sensory neurons. The thin dendrites of each of these neurons run to the surface of the epithelium, where these bear a cluster of about 20 modified cilia that function as receptor site. So, the dendrite run to the surface of the epithelium. Here you can see 20 modified cilia that acts as the receptor sites. These cilia extend from the olfactory epithelium. Here you can see the thin coating of nasal mucus that is secreted by the supporting cells and the olfactory gland. Mucus secretion is very important for olfaction. So, these cilia are actually embedded in a mucus coating. The mucus is a solvent that captures and dissolves the airborne odor molecules. So, the smell is these molecules, odor creating molecules, they are captured and dissolved in the mucus. Here in the mucus, once dissolved, the chemicals will bind to the specific receptors on the cilia that will stimulate the receptor cells. This causes depolarization and the action potential in the receptor cell. Once again, the odor molecules, they will get dissolved in the mucous membrane. They activate certain receptors in the cilia that will cause depolarization and the creation of action potential. And the axons of the olfactory receptors, all these unite to form the olfactory nerve. Here you can see the axons, they are all connected to form the olfactory nerve that transmit the information to the olfactory bulb. This is the olfactory bulb. You can see the olfactory bulb direct in contact with the brain. So, information directly to the overlying olfactory bulb, a relay station in the brain. The axons of olfactory receptors directly extend from the nasal cavity into the olfactory bulb, that is actually a part of the brain. The number of receptors stimulated indicates the strength of the stimulus. How far you can smell? That is determined by the number of receptors stimulated. Now, certain general features. The nasal cavity contains pain receptors that respond to irritants such as ammonia, vinegar or hot chili pepper. Impulses from these pain receptors, they reach the brain. The brain combines these sensations with those of the smell to identify the odors. Although humans do not have a good sense of smell, we can detect about 10,000 different odors. Our olfactory capability is not as good as those of many vertebrates, especially fish and mammals such as dog. The sense of taste. Now, we'll see the gustation. The sense of taste and smell work closely together. If we cannot smell something, then we cannot taste it either. Okay? When we speak of taste sensation, we are often referring to the combined sensation produced by both taste and sense receptors. The receptor cells for taste are located in taste buds. Here you can see the projections. These are the taste buds. Here you can see the projection, taste buds. Humans have about 10,000 taste buds. The majority of these taste buds are located in pockets around the papilla. What are papilla? Peg-like projections of the mucous membrane on the surface and side of the tongue. Here you can see on the surface and on the side of the tongue, there are projections called papilla. And here you can see the taste buds. But there are some on the surface of pharynx and larynx also. Each taste bud contains about 40 specialized receptor cells called gustatory cells. Here you can see these dark, cells are the gustatory cells. More supporting cells and some basal cells. And here you can see some supporting cells as well as basal cells. The receptor cells for taste are not neuron. Before I said that olfactory receptors are bipolar neuron. But unlike that, the receptor cells for taste are not neurons, but rather specialized cells with slender microvilli on the outer ends. Here you can see the presence of microvilli on the outside end. The microvilli protrude into the surrounding fluid through a narrow opening called the taste pore. So, there is an opening. This is one taste bud. There is an opening through which the Microvilli project out, and this opening is called the micropyle or the taste pore. Dissolved chemical substances contain contacting the microvilli bind to specific receptor proteins of the microvilli, thus depolarizing the cell. The dendrites of the associated sensory neuron coil intimately around the receptor cells and synapse with them. When a receptor cell is stimulated and depolarized, it releases the neurotransmitter that leads to the generation of an action potential in the associated sensory neuron. So listen carefully. Substances dissolved in the mucus will activate certain special proteins in the microvilli of the receptor cells. Here you can see the taste fibers of the cranial nerves intimately associated with the gustatory cells. So when a action potential is created in the taste bud, taste receptor cells, they are passed on to the taste fibers of the cranial nerves. Each dendrite receives signals from several receptor cells within the taste bud. This is each dendrite. Here you can see the branches. They receive the impulses from several taste cells. Nerve fibers emerging from the taste bud pass to the brainstem. From here, the nerve impulse is relayed to the taste center in the cerebral cortex that perceives the taste sensation. In human, there are four basic tastes. What are they? Sweet, sour, salt, and bitter. The receptor for these four basic tastes have their areas of greatest concentration. You can see the sweet and salt on the front, that is the tip of the tongue. Sour on the lateral side of the tongue. Bitter on the back. Okay. Salt and salty and sweet on the tip of the tongue. Sour on the lateral sides of the tongue. And bitter at the back of the tongue. Now the last sense of touch. Skin is the sensory organ for touch and it is also called the largest sense organ. Touch sensation comes from millions of microscopic simple sensory receptors located all over the skin and associated with the general sensation of contact, pressure, heat, cold and pain. That is millions of microscopic simple sensory receptors located all over the skin, general sensation of contact, pressure, heat, cold and pain. The receptors are located at different levels within the skin and distributed unevenly. Some parts of the body have a large number of these, such as the fingertip, making them more sensitive. So these are the sensory receptors in the skin, like the free nerve endings, Puccinian corpuscle, mucinous corpuscles, etc. Now the sense of touch, here you have to study three different categories under the touch, that is free or bare dendritic nerve endings, mucinous corpuscle and the Puccinian corpuscle. Now the free or bare nerve endings are present throughout the epidermis, taking an extensive branching out zigzag form. So this is present at the epidermal area in a branching form. These respond chiefly to pain and temperature, as well as to pressure. The root hair plexus, what is root hair plexus? Network of free nerve endings that surround the hair follicles. These are light touch receptors that detect the bending of hairs. And here you can see the root hair plexus. That is the network of free nerve endings at the base of the hair follicle and they are light touch receptors. And they report on the wind blowing through your hair. Mucinous corpuscles are small receptors where a few spiraling dendrites are surrounded by specialized capsule, that is the Schwann cell. So this is the mucinous corpuscle, few spiraling dendrites covered by the Schwann cell or the capsular cell. These are found just beneath the skin epidermis in dermal papilla. So the free nerve endings are found in the epidermis and the mucinous corpuscle found just below the epidermis. And they are abundant in fingertips and soles of the feet. They are light pressure receptors that allow us to become aware of the caress or the feel of our shirt against our skin. Puccinian corpuscles are large egg-shaped bodies. Here the These are large egg-shaped bodies. A single dendrite is surrounded by multi-layers of capsular cell. Here in my Meissner's, many spiraling dendrites surrounded by a single capsular cell. They are scattered deep in the dermis and in the subcutaneous tissue. They are found on the lower side, that is deep in the dermis. These are stimulated by deep pressure, respond only when the pressure is first applied. Thus, these receptors are best suited to monitor vibration. Touch allows us to detect different textures, temperatures, hardness and pain. Pain serves as a warning or alert system for the body. Whenever one or more of these sensory receptors are stimulated, an impulse or action potential is generated. These are taken to the spinal cord and from there the brain, which analyzes the stimulus and generates the appropriate response. Now coming to the questions. Number 1, find the wrong statement regarding the human eye. A. The eyeball is 3-layered, that is sclera, choroid and retina. B. The retina is 3-layered, ganglion cells, bipolar cells and photoreceptor cells. The photopic vision is function of rods and scotopic vision is the function of cones. D. The space between the cornea and lens is aqueous chamber and the space between lens and retina is the vitreous chamber. E. The fovea is a thinned portion of the retina where only cones are densely packed. So find the wrong statement. The answer is C. Why it is wrong? Because the photopic vision is a function of cones and the scotopic vision is a function of rods actually. Find the wrong match. Puccinian corpuscles, deep pressure receptors, free nerve endings, pain and temperature, Meissner's corpuscle, light pressure receptors, olfactory receptors, bipolar sensory neurons, organ of Corti, cochlea. Answer is olfactory receptors. These are actually not multipolar sensory neuron. They are actually bipolar sensory neuron. Cristae concerned with dynamic equilibrium are found in A. Utriculus, B. Sacculus, C. Vestibule, D. Ampulla of semicircular canal, E. Organ of Corti. And the answer is D. Ampulla of semicircular canals. Endolymph filled space in cochlea is A. Scala tympani, B. Scala vestibuli, C. Scala media vestibule and E. Utricle. And the answer is C. Scala media. This is the endolymph filled space. These two are perilymph filled spaces. 5. Find the correct statement regarding taste buds. A. They are located in the papilla on the surface of the tongue. B. Taste receptor cells are not neurons. C. Taste receptor cells possess microvilli on their outer end. Taste buds open out through taste pores. E. All the above. And the answer is all the above, because all these above 4 statements are true regarding the taste buds. Thank you. With this, I conclude.